Bye. taken out of it by the straight head. Sometimes I have to be careful, I just want to go. I have to be careful, finish my race here on earth.
Amen.
That's right. We need you here.
But you know what? I think the older you get, the more anxious you are to go to heaven. It's like, Lord, I'm just so looking forward to heaven. I have to be careful to finish my race here on earth.
Amen.
Yeah. But it's been a good ride.
Vacation that never ends.
Never is. Hallelujah. Well, we're going to pray right now for those who are sick. And we've got Sandra sick this morning. And you know Sandra probably sick, but she's not here.
Yes.
I've seen her come when she could barely walk with chemo and after her surgery. And Diana is sick. So let's pray for those. Anyone else that's sick? Lord, we just bring those among us who are sick. And Lord, we ask that we send forth your healing virtue to heal them.
Yes.
And Lord, that even by this evening, they will both begin to feel better. And they'll say, I got to get to church. So Lord, I ask you to even send ministering angels to minister to them. And Lord, that they shall arise just as you arose. On Easter Sunday morning, they will arise and say, hallelujah, he's alive. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, my message today, the great sunrise. And on Easter Sunday, just like Christmas, we have one message to preach in our Christian pulpits. And that is, he is alive.
Amen. Amen.
He's risen from the dead. He walked out of that tomb.
Amen.
And every Easter Sunday, we preach that same glorious message. I have at least 20 Resurrection Sunday messages. I could just go in and pick one out. But I ask the Lord to be sure that I'm saying what he's saying this Sunday. And then I'm saying what the Spirit of God is saying to the churches. But I did pull my... when I taught John 20, and I pulled some of that. So I did go back and pull up something from my old message, but I called it the Great Sunrise. And Jesus told the disciples, a little while and you will not see me. And that time is now past. Psalm 30, verse 5. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning.
Amen.
I can promise you, in my 79 years of walking on this earth, there have many times of weeping. There was a time of weeping where I wept in my sleep. And I woke up, my pillow was wet because I was weeping a long time ago. But I can promise you, no matter what life throws at you, joy will come in the morning. There will be a sunrise morning as you follow holy after the Lord.
Yes.
This I can tell you.
Amen.
Isaiah 21:11. Watchmen, what of the night? Watchmen, what of the night? The watchman said, the morning cometh. The watchmen are the intercessors, and the watchmen will tell you the morning cometh. We're at a great sunrise in America right now. We have had victory. I'm talking about victory for the kingdom of God. Victory after victory after victory. The president of the United States has been totally found not guilty. That is the good news for the whole nation. But there has been one victory after the other victory after the other victory. We are in a time of resurrection glory over this nation. The battle, my friends, is not against a political party. It is not about any political party. It is the spirit of Antichrist against Christianity.
Amen.
This is the battle we're in, and we have come to a resurrection morning God is giving us breakthrough after breakthrough after breakthrough.
Yes.
And I am prophesying to you that in this coming year, that abortion is going to be high on the list of the battle that's over this nation. They don't want it to be. They're going to run from it, but it will be. John 20, verse 1. Early in the morning on the first day of the week, they came into the sepulcher at the rising of the sun. Isaiah 30, 26. The light of the sun shall be sevenfold as the light of 7 days, in the day that the Lord binds up the breach of his people and heals the stroke of their wound. United States of America, and some of you in your own personal life, you've been under some wounding the last 5 or 6 years. You've been going through something really tough. If you haven't, raise your hand and I'll say hallelujah with you. But the 5 or 6 years, God has proved us. He has tested us.
Yes.
As we have gone through different things, he has strengthened us. As you went through whatever suffering and sorrow and loss and pain that you had to go through, you came out stronger on the other side.
Yeah.
Or else you came out bitter. I'd say get over it. Well, it won't do you any good to be bitter at anyone or anything.
That's right.
Oh, happy day for a benighted world. We're in a day of resurrection glory, church.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. They say they had some statistics that church attendance has gone down and it's not going up. Well, if God is moving in resurrection glory over this nation, then he's going to start moving in resurrection glory to restore his church.
Yeah.
I have lived long enough to see the Spirit of God move upon a sleeping, dead church and to raise us up again in the fire of God. The brighter than the brightest earthly sun has come forth from his chamber of death, rejoicing more than ever as a giant to run his course. He has turned the shadow of death into the morning, as in morning. The darkness is past and the true light now shines. And because his darkness is past, you and I have promise that there will always be a morning after.
Hallelujah.
There will always be a new day. That no matter what we walk through, there's going to always be a third day.
That's right.
We read the scripture this morning, Matthew 28, 1 through 7, but I'm going to read it again. In the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulchre. Behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. His countenance was like lightning and his raiment white as snow. For fear of him, the keepers did shake and became as dead men. There's much conversation among theologians that the angel of the Lord is the Lord himself. Mm-hmm. And it might be, but just as you have an angel, our Lord has an angel. And see, Jesus was walking around outside the tomb.
Right.
His angel was left to deliver the message.
Sitting on the rock, amen.
Yeah, sitting on a rock, absolutely, day two.
Right.
First day of the week. There's a scripture in Romans, and I had it in my original teaching, but I took it out, that as Christians, we are not to give place to dates.
Amen, come on.
The day unto the Lord is the day that matters. We're not to give place to days.
Amen.
But we have every day that we worship the Lord is our day, Christian's day. So let's don't get hung up on what day we worship the Lord. Let's worship him every day.
Amen. Amen.
But on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary have returned to the tomb after the others have left. They see the stone taken away from the entrance of the tomb. The angel spoke to the women, "Fear not, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen. And the angel said, come see the place where the Lord lay. And go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead. Behold, he goes before you into Galilee. There you shall see him. Lo, I have told you.
Amen.
There's a lot of conversation out there now about angels, and you will hear a lot more. Because there have been doctrines that tell you that we can't interact with angels. These angels speak. They speak back to them. They talk to the angels.
Amen.
They see the angels. And the angels talk to men all the way through the Bible.
Amen.
My Bible says that God, that in him there is no shadow of turning. That what he was yesterday, he is today, and he will be tomorrow.
That's what my Bible says.
And his kingdom is no shadow of turning. And established his kingdom on earth.
Yeah.
His kingdom hasn't changed. People, your angels should be talking to you.
Amen.
How can you talk to your angels if you're not even recognizing that they're around you?
That's right.
They might be telling you all kinds of good stuff and you're just going on doing your thing. The first day has since been called the Lord's Day. Not only because he rose that day, but because the new creation, I said the new creation, the new man. I'm the new man. Are you the new man?
Amen.
The new creation man, based on his redemption work, also began on Sunday. 7 Sundays later, Pentecost, Jesus returned in the Spirit to begin the work of building his church. Now, there are all kinds of teachings out there that the church is just any old kind of way, and it's all loose, and there's nothing organized about the church. Well, the Lord set up 5 offices to govern his church.
Amen.
And he chooses who those people are. They're chosen by God.
Yes.
That's right.
They're chosen and sent. Now, there's a lot of them that mama sent and daddy called.
Right.
Mama called, that's what it is. Mama called and daddy sent. Yeah.
Some just go.
But God sent into place his offices. It hasn't changed.
That's right. Amen.
And there are many spirits of Jezebel and many spirits of control that want to just come in and say, well, hey, we're all in charge. Well, that's great. Go ahead and do it if you can. But you can't do it without the power of God in you.
Amen.
You cannot do it.
Amen.
You cannot do it.
Amen.
Without the power of God.
Yes.
The pressure will kill you. Our Sunday worship is an extension of that first Pentecostal Sunday. This is not merely a day of physical rest per the Jewish Sabbath, Saturday, but a day of spiritual work for Christ. True rest of God. The book of Hebrews says that not everyone will enter that rest. And that the Hebrew nation that came out of Egypt did not enter the rest of God. People, I don't know about you, but I live in that rest. In that rest, there's no fretting, there's no worry, there's no anxiety. This week, a Sunday night we went out, Joanne discovered I had a leak in my front yard. So I called out Severin Trent right away. They came at 9 o'clock, and I forget what they said. Anyway. But anyway, I had to call Plumber. Well, he had to come out the next day. I've had 8 men knock my house this week. Not one of us, 15 now. But you know what? I did not get anxious. But one time they came out and said it was on me, you know, which could be thousands of dollars. And then, but the end up result is not on me, it's on them, and they're going to have to go under the street, over to the other fellow's yard, and tear it up to fix my leak.
Oh, no.
It'll take them all next week if they get out here next week. I got water standing in my yard, standing in the street. And my point is, I have a point to this. I didn't get up.
That's right.
Thank you, Jesus.
I didn't raise my voice at these 7 different workmen. One of them charged me $300 to come out.
Your neighbor might get upset.
Well, I talked to him. He's very calm about it. The one across the street might get upset.
Yeah.
But my point is, when it looked like the first thing would look like I might pay out thousands of dollars. And I'm trying to think, Lord, where are we going? How are we going to do this, you know? But I began to cry.
That's it. Mm-hmm.
And I said, Lord, you and Don picked out this house. I was left out of the equation. They hit it over my screaming body. They did. I spoke to Don. And I got in my bed just boo-hooing because I wanted another house. It's all true. Don came in. He said, Trump, do you think God would speak to me? He said, I think God just spoke to me and told me to buy this house. I don't act like that ever. But I remember, yes, over this water thing. And I said, God, you and Don picked out this house. I need you to fix my water line.
That's right. Thank you, Lord.
It's not going to cost me a penny, except for that $300 I paid to come. Tell me nothing. Okay. This is my point. Christian, if you're entering into the rest of God, there's nothing you have to sweat.
That's right. That's right.
Alan, nothing you have to sweat.
Fret not.
Fret not.
First church of the fret not.
First church of the fret not. If I can get y'all to the fret not, think how happy you'll be.
Yes.
I had 7 men walked into my yard. I still got a puddle of water out there. Well, I prayed for every one of them. Entering the rest of God, the true rest of God, is a walk of faith. Ministry is not a business. Ministry is a walk of faith.
Yes, yes.
The Lord had to take me out of my business mind and give me a faith mind, yes, in order to make a pastor out of me. Mm-hmm. The Christian Sabbath provides spiritual rest for our souls. It is for those belonging to the new creation and those who are alive. Those who are alive in Christ. I'm alive in Christ. In Him I live and move and have my being. What should I worry about? Anything on this earth? Whatever comes my way, I'm His problem.
Glory.
John in his gospel gives us more details of Mary's encounter with the angels. Now Mary remained outside the tomb weeping. In the process of pouring out her grief, she bent down and looked into the tomb. There she beheld 2 angels in white, sitting one at the head and the other at the feet, where the body of Jesus had lain. The ministry of angels, okay, JT, I need you to take authority over that. The ministry of angels is as natural in the kingdom of God at the ministry of the saints. Do you hear me?
Mm-hmm.
It should be as natural in our interacting as the ministry of the saints. These angels were messengers from heaven, sent with a mission and a message. Okay, your interaction, God has released, is my persuasion, there has been 10,000 times 10,000 times 10,000 of angels released on the earth right now.
Yes.
Okay, if they have been released on the earth right now, they have a mission and they have a message.
Sure.
They have a mission and they have a message.
Yeah.
They're sent here for a purpose.
Yes.
We need to be cooperating with them, with what God has sent them here to do. Yeah. We need to get in with their mission and we need to declare their message.
Yes. Yeah.
And they only do what the Holy Spirit tells them to do.
Amen.
So don't worry about worshiping an angel. He won't let you.
That's right.
That's right.
If it's an angel, Lord, He won't let you worship it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Lord, help me preach this.
Yes.
Their message was to declare He's alive. Now the Son of God was again to be brought into the world, and the angels have a charge to attend him in the tomb as the angels did at his birth. They're sent to comfort the saints, and by giving them notice that the Lord was risen, to prepare them for the sight of him who is alive. How many angels? There were two. Not a multitude of the heavenly host, as when he was born, to sing praise. Only two to bear witness. They were in white, denoting their purity and holiness. And these angels sat at Christ's grave. The different gospels have a little bit different interpretation. I'm choosing this one because when I entered the tomb in Israel, there was an angel at the door that tapped me on the shoulder. And said, he's not here, he's alive. I think Joanne said when I came back, I said, he's still alive. I had to look up my original, what it was fresh on my mind then, he's alive. And I looked at the concrete slate, and there was another angel sitting at the end, and then there's another area over here, and I think there was another angel there. But see, these angels were sent with a mission and a message, and they haven't changed their message. Mm-hmm. They're still telling people who come in, who have ears to hear, mm-hmm. and who are aware, are sensitive, who can see in the Spirit and hear in the Spirit, he still declares the same message.
Amen.
He's alive. Amen. I've heard that story many times. You'll probably hear it every Easter. Mm-hmm. These angels went into the grave to teach us not to be afraid of it. They're sitting to face one another, one at bed's head and the other at bed's feet. They also remind us of two cherubim, not with flaming swords to keep us from the garden, but welcome messengers to welcome us to the way of life. Life abundantly, not just barely making it down here on this earth, Christian. He wants to give you an abundant life, but it's only found in him. It is not found in the world system.
Amen.
And the angel spoke to Mary, saying, woman, why are you weeping? She says, because they have taken my Lord away, and I do not know where they have laid him. As soon as she said this, she turned away, and then she saw Jesus standing there without realizing it was he. Then Jesus spoke to her. Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking? Supposing him to be the gardener, see, he looked like a man. She said, sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away. Mm. And Jesus said to her, Mary. And she turned to move toward him, and as she did, she exclaimed in Hebrew, Rabboni, my finest master, teacher, my great one. Never did a royal trumpet blast declare such a tale of victory as the sound of the Master's voice. Not for you. Whatever dark place you're going through, whatever hardship you're going through, the Master's voice will call your name. I like to tell the story about Chris Monkey. The Lord called his name. You see, the Lord calls you by that. He was supposed to be in a dream, and he told me to set up the billing account. We haven't had much activity, in case y'all want to know. And he told me to make Chris Bunky to keep the books on. Mm-hmm. So that means God called his name. Mm-hmm. God will call your name. God will call your name for what he wants you to do. The same voice that first spoke peace to her troubled soul and cast out the seven devils that had long ruled her wretched body, he now calls his sheep, his own sheep, by name, and he leads her out. He is fulfilling his own sweet promise contained in the prophecy about the smitten shepherd and the scattered sheep. And when she turned to move toward him, Jesus said, don't cling to me. Now in Matthew it says that the women worshipped at his feet. But in John it says, don't cling to me, for I have not yet ascended to my Father and your Father, my God, and your God. Now see, that's another way that we can tell that the angel of the Lord came from heaven And Jesus was still on earth because he had not yet ascended to heaven, and the angel of the Lord came from heaven. So Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news. I have seen the Lord, and he has spoken these things to her. What a privilege was hers to be the first preacher of the gospel of Jesus Christ. She was the first preacher, God chose a woman to give the message to Peter. John didn't see the angels. Mary Magdalene did. I'll hear the song of the empty tomb, telling, witnessing resurrection. It rings with the voice of angelic ones. He's not here. He is risen. The women departed quickly from the sepulchre with fear and great joy, and did run to bring his disciples word. Peter and the other disciples set out at once for the tomb, the two of them running together. For a time they ran side by side. But then the other disciple, and that would be John, ran ahead of Peter to reach the tomb first. Well, he was young. Stooping down so that he could look inside, he saw the linen clothes lying there, and he didn't go in. Close behind came Simon Peter, who went directly into the tomb, where he beheld the linen wrappings and the face cloth which had been about his head, not lying with the other wrappings, but folded in a place by itself. There is no way to remove a body from the Jewish method of lining a corpse without disturbing the folds. The face cloth lying intact and folded is overwhelming evidence. Indeed, it was Jewish custom to fold a napkin at the dinner table, indicating the person would return. This would totally wipe out the guard's false story, because if someone came and got the body, they wouldn't have unwrapped the body to take the body out. They would have just taken the body wrapped. Then the disciples who reached the tomb first also went in, and when he saw the evidence, he believed. For at this point, they had not yet understood the scripture, which said he must rise again from the dead. Psalm 16:10. For you will not leave my soul in hell, neither will you suffer your Holy One to see corruption.
Amen.
Okay, that is also your promise, saint. Your soul is not going to hell. You're going straight to heaven, and you're not going to suffer the corruption of your flesh. Your spirit, man, is going straight to be with Jesus. Three different Greek verbs are used for this incident to show how the two disciples reacted to the evidence. John looked, and he saw. Peter saw the linens. He beheld them critically and carefully, but he didn't understand. John entered the tomb. He saw, and then he believed. He believed the Lord had risen from the dead, and he said, as he said he would, destroy this temple, and I will raise it again in 3 days. Late that same Sunday evening, the disciples had met together behind closed doors for fear of the Jews. Jesus came and stood in the midst of them. Peace be with you, he said. And then he showed him his hands and his side. And when the disciples saw the Lord, they were overjoyed. 3 days earlier, the disciples had forsaken Jesus, scattering each to his own business. People, they betrayed him and they abandoned him. In your lifetime, you will suffer betrayal and you will suffer abandonment. And if you hold that against the people who betrayed you and abandoned you, you need to be the first one on the altar, not the person who betrayed you and abandoned you. Jesus forgave them.
Amen.
What then brings them to this room? They were shivering in fear. The town is alive with the reports of his resurrection. Different ones, including Peter, have seen him. And some of our companions went to the tomb. Several of them went over there and found it just as women had said, but him they did not see. Those who walk with the Lord expected him to do the unusual. They had seen and forgive a woman who had five husbands, honor a pint-sized thief disguised as a tax collector, and love a streetwalker whose reputation would have brought blushes to the faces of Bonnie and Clyde. They'd seen him scare the devil out of some demoniacs and put the fear of God in some churchgoers. Traditions had tumbled, lepers had leaped, sinners had sung, Pharisees had fumed, multitudes had been moved. You just don't pick up the bags and go home after 3 years like that. Suddenly, he's in their midst, miraculously. His first greeting calms their frightened spirits. Peace be with you. Church, I don't know what you're going through in your life, but God's message to you is peace. They relax as their fears subside. A repentant heart is all he demands. Come out of the shadows. Be done with your hiding. A repentant heart is enough to summon the Son of God himself to walk through our walls of guilt and shame. He who forgave his followers stands ready to forgive the rest of us.
Amen.
All we have to do is come back.
Mm-hmm.
It was God's plan for Jesus to appear in the same body after the resurrection. It was the one sign promised an evil generation. In Matthew 12:39-41, remember when they asked him for a sign and he said there will be no sign given to you except the prophet Jonah? Jesus answered, "The wicked and adulterous generation asked for a miraculous sign, but none will be given it except the sign of the prophet Jonah. For as Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights in the belly of a huge fish, so the Son of Man shall be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth. The men of Nineveh will stand up at the judgment of this generation and condemn it. For they repented at the preaching of Jonah, and now one greater than Jonah is here." United States of America, I don't know who's going to judge you, but you're without excuse. You have 40 different kinds of Bibles. If you don't like one, you can read the other. They all say the same thing. You have CDs and tapes and Christian television and Christian radio. There's a church on every corner.
Yes.
There are preachers looking for a pulpit everywhere. You're without excuse, church. Who will judge us? Then Jesus repeated his salutation, saying, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I also send you." When he said this, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit." He bears no grudge for their desertion. He advised the disciples the commission he received from his Father did not end at the cross. The miraculous powers of Jesus Christ did not end at the cross. The miracles of God did not end at the cross.
Amen.
Healing did not end at the cross. The ministry of angels did not end at the cross.
Yes.
The ministry of the Holy Spirit did not end at the cross.
Amen.
Out of that, his seed went into the ground, and up came a glorious, powerful church.
Yes.
12 apostles went through the whole earth preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ, and through the power of that seed that went into the ground, there came forth a glorious church.
Amen.
How can preachers stand in the pulpit and water down this gospel?
Yes.
Their desertion of him did not cost their status as apostles. He chose them. If God chooses you, and you're all chosen, whatever your season is with the Lord, we have different seasons with the Lord. God uses me for whatever he wants to on any day if he wants to. That's why people are confused about what office I stand in. He says, if it's Caroline, I need an evangelist, I'm going to send you out. He says, Caroline, I need you an apostle. I want you to go help govern some things that are messed up. Caroline, I need a prophet. Here's my word. Caroline, I need a preacher. I need you to go and help guard some people because Satan is trying to steal them. Mm-hmm. And Caroline, I need a teacher because I need you to disciple some people and I need you to ground them.
Amen.
Because they don't know the word of God and they can't walk it. So we don't get caught up too much. But they didn't lose their status as apostles. The breath of God is a regular metaphor in the scripture for the Holy Spirit. And the first diffusion of the breath of God made man a living being. And here the breath of the risen Christ made the disciples into new men. There's a difference of opinion as whether the Holy Spirit was not fully imparted at this moment. Luke 24:33 suggests that others besides the 10 disciples were present here. If you receive the breath of God, you receive the Holy Spirit. At Pentecost, they received the fire, the tongue, the Holy Spirit, the gifts of the Holy Spirit, the power of the Holy Spirit. But they had the Holy Spirit when Jesus breathed into them, Jesus breathed in me. If you forgive anyone his sins, they are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven. Some of the commentaries say this is not really what Jesus meant when he spoke to the disciples that day. And they will rephrase it to say what they think he meant to say based on his lifelong ministry of forgiveness. I believe that view can be defined as redefinition of Scripture.
That's right.
There's a lot of redefinition of the scriptures going on right now. His words on the cross were, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. He forgave those who persecuted him. He taught that we must forgive in order to be forgiven. Matthew Henry teaches it as an apostolic authority. If they had not had an extraordinary spirit of discerning, they would not have been trusted with such an authority. Now, talking about the authority of, if you forgive anyone his sins, they are forgiven.
Yes.
You do not forgive them, they are not forgiven.
Yes.
Well, we could fight about that all day. It must be understood as a general charter to the church and her ministers, encouraging the faithful stewards of the mysteries of God to stand to the gospel they were sent to preach. God will stand with us if we preach the gospel that we are sent to preach. Whatever God uses me in, and he is welcome to do as he pleases. I am sent to preach the gospel.
Yes.
I am not sent to entertain you.
Amen.
I am not sent to give you a feel-good sermon.
Amen.
I am sent to stand and preach the gospel as it is written.
Yes. Amen.
And if I don't do that, I am not doing what God called me to do. And when I get to heaven, I sure won't hear well done.
Amen.
Amen.
Ooh, glory. Those whom the gospel acquits shall be acquitted. And those whom the gospel condemns shall be condemned. This puts immense honor upon the ministry and should put immense courage into ministers. It should almost also put fear of God in you.
Yes.
By sound doctrine, they are commissioned to tell the world on gospel terms and no other. David J. Ellis. These words, properly understood, refer to the disciples as the first nucleus of the Spirit-filled society. Its ministry in the gospel will be effectual. Some will be forgiven. Others will reject its message and be hardened. When the church functions as the true body of Christ, she can pronounce on sin with the same assurance as Jesus when he gave this command.
Yes.
You know me, if you come to the, you're not going to, for a counsel, you're not going to get any easy believers.
Mm-hmm.
Some people come to me for counsel and they just come and tell me what they're doing. They're not coming for prayer, they're not coming for counsel. They just come and tell me this is what I'm doing and I feel like this is what God wants me to do. God bless you.
Amen.
You didn't come to me that for me to pray with you. Or for you to ask what God wanted. You just come tell me what you're going to do and trying to clear yourself with God.
That's right.
Yes.
Now, I'm not speaking of everybody that comes to counsel, because I can call names, I tell you what. So usually they don't come to me for counsel. They come to me to tell me this is what I'm going to do. Mm-hmm. And I really don't care what God thinks about it.
Yeah. Yeah. Stop my own church.
As Jesus prophesied it would be. Judgment did fall on those who did not receive him. This is an apostolic authority given to the apostles. Jesus' death on the cross bore all of our sin, grief, and sorrow, but it is conditional. We have to receive him as our Savior. If we will not, his death and resurrection condemns us. Christ had nothing but stinging words of rebuke for those who dwell in the tongue of religion. Hypocrites, he called them. I tell you, we got some hypocrites. I'm not watching TV this weekend, just so y'all know. I flipped on my TV, see if anybody knows anything. Nobody knows nothing. They're just still hashing and rehashing what didn't happen with the viewer report. And they're just and then they're hypocrites about it all because they've done, you know, it's pitiful. The news media, multiple times during this season, have been left speechless.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. With nothing to say. God has took their very voice out of their mouth and left them with nothing to say, and they're up there going, blah, blah, blah.
Mm-hmm.
But. Didn't do anything.
They're in trouble. France is in trouble right now, and church, we better be praying for that nation. Oh, okay, so I'll move on here. God was actors, fence builders, inflexible judges, unauthorized hedge trimmers, hair splitters, and blind guides. Whitewashed tombs, snakes, and vipers. Bang, bang, bang. Jesus had no room for those who specialized in making religion a warlord and faith a foot race. No room at all. Joseph and Nicodemus were tired of it too. They had seen it for themselves. They had seen the list of rules and regulations. They had watched the people tremble under unbearable burdens. They had heard the hours of senseless wrangling over legalistic details. They had worn the robes and sat at the place of honor and seen the word of God be made void. They had seen religion become the crutch that cripples. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Supposed to lift y'all up today. I'm calling this church. Walk before the Lord, repentant.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I have to repent every day I do. The Bible is one story after another of God using man's best and overcoming man's worst. The reassuring lesson is clear. God used and uses people to change the world. People. Not saints or superhumans or geniuses, but everyday, ordinary people. Crooks, creeps, lovers and liars, he uses them all.
Mm-hmm.
I know a few. And I've seen God use them. I've seen the gifts of the Spirit go through them. I've seen the gifts of the Spirit operate through people that just didn't know how to behave, JT. They didn't know anything, and God still spoke through them. What God, what they lacked in perfection, God made up for it in love. What a glad Sunday that was for Christ's friends and disciples and for the Church of Christ. For the ages of time, that divine Son who had so lately gone down in the darkness of the tomb has risen, never again to set. Love's redeeming work is done, fought the fight. Lo, the sun's eclipse is o'er. Lo, he sets his blood. No. Why would you not be a warrior? Why would you not be afraid? Why would you not become an overcomer? Why would you not stand and triumphantly declare that the gospel of Jesus Christ is finished? That the work of the Old Testament is finished? That he has come? He has overcome death, hell, and the grave. And he has risen from the dead.
Yes.
And he is going to keep you alive
until
that time that he's ready to take you home.
Yes.
You may have to suffer. You will. If you hang around this life long enough, you're going to do some suffering.
Mm-hmm.
He'll take us through it just to prove us.
Mm-hmm.
Right, Ben? I tried my rose-covered garden. I lived it a long time. Then I got thrown out.
Amen.
Let me see how much I like being finished here. I'm close. We're okay on time, aren't we? Thomas the twin was one of the 12 and was not with them when Jesus came. When the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord," Thomas replied, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands, and I put my fingers into the very nail holes themselves, and shove my hand into his side, you will never get me to believe it. I will tell you that when I was raptured into heaven, and I saw this colossal Jesus, and I was taken into his stomach, and then my light was taken through the nail scar." Doing, huh? If you had a vision like that, how could you not keep doing?
Amen. Right.
You don't stop preaching the gospel. You don't stop saying, "I have seen Jesus alive. And he took me through his nail-carved hand," because somebody doesn't like you and doesn't think you ought to be preaching and you don't have the right credentials, or you should not be doing this because of your gender or any other idea. You don't stop preaching that gospel once you have seen it and know it.
Amen.
And you don't stop preaching it until you draw your last breath.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Good word.
Because you can't help yourself. And if you don't listen, you know what? The trees will. I'll go get me a stump and stand out right out in the woods. And you know what? The trees and the birds are going to hear me. But I won't stop preaching. What a glad Sunday that was for Christ's friends and disciples. Honest, intellectual, truth loving skeptic that Thomas was. Remember, he was the one, he was one of the that came up to him and said, let us also go that we may die with Jesus. Yeah. But Thomas stands his ground. He stated the terms under which he would believe Jesus has risen. And since the Lord has already said, none is lost except the son of perdition, we can expect him to rescue Thomas from his despair and doubting condition. He knew he had a winner in Thomas. See, God knows when he has a winner in you. Say, sunshine, you're a winner. God has a winner in you. There's a fight in you and a warrior. God says, sunshine, I picked you as a winner. I even gave you my name. Legend has him hopping a freighter to India, where they had to kill him to get him to quit talking about his home prepared in the world to come. Friend who came back from the dead. But you know, I visited Thomas's tomb in India, and I'll keep telling that story to him. I can declare to you, the presence of the Lord fills the room, and I had witnesses where a portion of his bones still remains. The apostolic presence in that room is all consuming. It is like standing in a room full of angels in that room where his bones are. Can't go to the cross with just your head and not your heart. It doesn't work that way. Calvary is not a mental trip. It's not an intellectual exercise. It's not a divine calculation or a cold theological principle. It's a heart-splitting hour of emotion. Don't walk away from it dry-eyed and unstirred. Don't just straighten your tie and clear your throat. Don't allow yourself to descend Calvary, cool and collected. Please pause and look again. Those are nails in those hands. And that's God on that cross. And it's me who's putting them there. Thomas answered and said to him, my Lord and my God. And Jesus said to him, Thomas, because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are they that have not seen and yet have believed. Shame. Not a word you've missed. You're going to make it.
Amen.
You know you have a destiny.
Yes.
You know that. You know that you have a destiny.
Mm-hmm.
I watched the movie Barabbas this week. I've never seen it before. If I did, I don't remember. It came out in 1961. Married in 1962, but I don't know how many years ago that was. You know, Barabbas was the one that they freed instead of Jesus. Of course, the movie was fiction. Why am I telling you this? I don't know. But we're going to figure it out as we go along. Barabbas was freed in place of Jesus. And as the fiction of the story was, of course, he was, you know, rough guy. But he could not die. He went through all of this terrible thing. They put him in prison. They put him in the sulfur mines. He did this and he did that. And they kept putting him in things that don't kill him. But he would not die. He could not die.
Mm-hmm.
And he felt it. He knew that as he was going through all this torture, he would say, when I was released, he knew. They said they couldn't kill him anymore because he had been released by the people. The people had forgiven him. But they kept torturing him all kinds of ways. And he spent this terrible time in it. He was looking for Jesus, trying to understand what this was. And in the end, he died on the cross. And of course, he made his peace with God. See, he went in your place and you know it. And there's a work that God, that you're doing. You're doing it now. Out of the marketplace. Not that like you're going to do it. Because there's going to be a change.
Mm-hmm.
And your words that come out of your mouth are going to begin to change.
Mm-hmm.
in the past, you would put people in their place if they blasphemed anything that had to do with God. You would do it, you got that much your mama and you straighten them out. It's going to change. It's going to be a weeping come upon you. It's going to be a weeping at the heart of spirit. And you will begin to see, you will begin to hear in your spirit the depth of his love for you.
Yes.
How he's kept you all these years.
Yes.
You will be known as the weeping prophet. Peter knew it, John knew it, Mary knew it, Thomas knew it. And they also somehow knew that history was being remade. They would soon be launched into history to never be the same again. I believe, and of course it's my faith, and I'm looking for the appearing of Jesus Christ. But when I tell you that I'm looking for his appearing, I'm looking for his appearing in you. I'm looking for his appearing in you, Sunshine. In Tim, JT. I'm looking for his appearing in the saints. But I'm also looking for his appearing in the air. And we will continue to look for his appearing. But I believe that right now in this time, there's a great visitation upon the earth. And only those who are looking for his appearing will know of this visitation. Peter knew it. John knew it. Mary knew it. Thomas knew it. And any other signs truly did Jesus in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God. And that believing you may have life through his name. 2 Samuel 23:3-5. The God of Israel said, the rock of Israel spoke to me. He shall be as the light in the morning when the sun rises, even a morning without clouds. As the tender grass springs out of the earth by clear shining after rain, he has made with me an everlasting covenant, ordered in all things and sure. For this is all my salvation and all my desire. I have no other desire.
Amen.
Helen, God has worked a healing in you.
It's true.
And I'm totally just fine.
There's a joy on your face. There's a peace on you. There's a freedom in your spirit. And it is God that has worked this on you. Lord says, I'm going to free you of some more things. There are some things that have attached themselves to you that God cannot put on you. But because you're a workhorse, you have taken on these things. But the Lord wants you free. He wants you to dance in the pastures with the wildflowers. He wants you to dance with him. And the Lord says, I'm going to free you to dance with me.
All right.
Shari, how long shall it be?
3 or 4 weeks.
Amen. Praise God.
Go ahead and pray for me.
Lord, we as babies, we've covered in prayer. Sanctified baby in your womb.
Yes.
Faithful, Shari.
Yes.
You know what? Even though you didn't pay, you want to ignore him and shut him up sometimes.
Yes.
You're going to have the same voice. That anointing that's on your daddy,
yep,
it's going on you.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
Not one run from it. You'll preach. Oh, you're not coming up here by accident, getting in that car, driving 50 miles?
It's further than that.
On Sunday morning with your baby?
Yes.
I say, I go to the closest church around the corner. Okay, you're gonna just, that's thing in your heart. Okay, now you will preach just like you have. Both of my daughters, as you know, have calls on their life, and they're doing it in different ways, but we're still running. Shannon will tell you. She's running from what it's gonna cost. But you're gonna do it anyway.
Amen.
Jesus.
I found this song that J.G. Bailey before it's 12 o'clock. We can't eat till 1. But I just thought it was lovely. I'm sure Joanne knows it. Somebody here might know it. Fear not, little flock, from the cross to the throne. From death into life, he went for his own. All power in earth, all power above, given to him for the flock of his love. Only believe, only believe. All things are possible, only believe. Now, anybody found any time? Now, y'all tell me y'all know this. Fear not, little flock, he goes ahead. Your shepherd selected the path you must tread. The waters of Marah, he'll sweeten for thee. He drank all the bitter in Gethsemane. Fear not, little flock, whatever your lot. He enters all rooms. The door's been shut. He never forsakes, and he never is gone. So count on his presence in darkness and dawn.
Amen.
Now, who knows that song?
My mom does.
You know it? Would you sing it for me?
I can't sing it anymore.
It's okay.
You can praise God.
See, let's give it a go. See if you can sing the... somewhere. And I thought, well, let me see, because it was in quotation, that must be happens, I put it on Google. And when I Googled it, this song came up.
And then that's her childhood song. Wow.
Might be on YouTube.
On goodness gracious.
And it was someone, a fellow by the name of J.G. Daly wrote it. And it does have, it's a real pleasant little tune to it. Jean, you gonna look for it?
Vicki Jameson used to sing that.
Who?
Vicki Jameson used to sing that on Brother Hagin's radio program.
Okay.
That was his theme song.
Do you know the song?
I have known the song.
You can sing.
I'm not
Jenny has more.
Yes, she does.
Only believe.
Come on now.
There we go.
All things are possible. Only believe.
Come on now. Okay, here's the only believe part of the chorus. And here's the first, okay?
Fill our little flock from the cross to the throne, from death into life, he went for his own. All power in earth, all power above, is given to him for the flock of his love. Only believe, only believe.
Brother, is it okay if I pray for you today?
Yes, Lord.
You been in the hospital with pneumonia? Lord, I thank you, God. I speak to these lungs. God, they be whole and be healed in Jesus' name. Lord, I breathe the breath of life today into this man of God. And Lord, that same breath of the Holy Spirit that you breathed into the apostles, Lord, I loose that breath of life into his lungs. And that these lungs shall live and they shall breathe and he shall fulfill that which you have called him to do. And he shall rise. He shall rise in life. And he shall rise in abundant life. And Lord, I rebuke any spirit that is stealing life from him. And I call forth the life of Christ to arise in him.
Amen.
Visiting your house. Wisdom and peace. Visiting your house. Wisdom and peace. Peace be unto you. I say peace be unto you. I say peace be unto you, man of God. To go there already. See, God had already chosen them. And he put them on the path. The shepherd put them on the path. God has a path. You're not doing this. But you see, God has chosen them. They're in the corner. Is it okay if I pray for you?
If you want.
Okay. Thank you. Would you come up and pray for you?
I don't want to be on.
You don't want to come up? Well, okay, I'll come to you. I'll come to you.
Thanks for letting me be lazy.
Okay, I'm not. Well, no, I got to keep my mind. Now everything's gone boom, 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 bang, bang, bang. Your whole life has opened up. Mm-hmm. Your whole life has opened up. Direction for a career. Direction for school. Direction for work. And you're very popular at work, by the way. Yeah, you're very popular. They all want Ashley at work. Fighting over you, huh? Are they fighting over you?
Not at all.
Not at all. They're going to. They're very popular at work. They're watch it. They like Ashley. Mm-hmm. Ashley's funny.
All right, you got me there. You got me there. That's the one thing they talk about with me is humor.
Sure. Yeah, yeah, and they like it. You're 18 now. Happy birthday. 19. How old you? Y'all remember when she was that tall at Red Eye Church?
Yeah, 6 years old.
She used to sit in the kitchen all the time and read her Bible.
That's why we moved somewhere that doesn't have a kitchen.
Yes. Kitchen to read the Bible on the floor.
Uh-huh.
Okay, 19. There's a romance in front of you.
Busted.
In the next 6 months, but don't be looking.
Don't want to look.
Okay, don't be looking. It's going to come to you, but it's going to be sweet. It's going to be healthy, and it's going to be a blessing. But it's not marriage. It's a friendship that will be a happy thing. But it's in this big boomerang that I see in front of you. Boomerang. Your whole life is gone. Boom! Ashley's here.
Yay!
Amen.
I love you.
Amen. And you need to go boom.
See you in 6 months.
Sarah's here. Boom! Sarah's here. I said boom! Sarah's here.
Just movie theaters and pop.
Oh, great.
But I pray that you open up heaven before her. And Lord, all that you have created her to be, all the suffering she's walked through, all the life challenges she's walked through, Lord, I ask you to open before her a gateway of the path of the shepherd that will lead her into a big life. Big life.
Amen.
You already got a big life, both of you. Miss Bonnie, you've got a hard road to hoe where you are. And as I said earlier, the Lord allows us to go through things to make us stronger. Now, you're already stronger than 99% of the people on the planet. And that's why you're there. Lord, temper this strength with wisdom. If he had, you have that temper. Now, is that judge that you're supposed to have favor with, if he come along and helped you?
He's learned. He didn't say anything this week because that Mueller report came out, and he was really ragging on me about how horrible Trump was, but this week he was kind of quiet.
There's a judge that God's really give you favor with. And that must be the one.
I have favor with him.
Yeah, so you're gonna have a lot more favor with him. He's going to give you a position or an assignment. It's gonna be a very high responsibility, but very trustworthy. Someone he would only give it to someone that he totally trusted. Okay.
One of them looked right at me, and he imparted your week to me. He showed me what was going on with the water. And I saw and I heard, when it happens, it all just comes so quickly sometimes into your mind. And anyways, I heard that God was saying that you had an overflow. It can't be contained.
Right.
and no man can fix it. And what you just did in this room was you imparted that overflow and you poured into everyone's cups. And anyways, it was just amazing to watch.
Or let it flow. Let it flow, let it flow, let it flow. And then let it flow out of you,
yes.
For you, for you. I said, prophet. I said, prophet. I said, weeping prophet, the book of Jeremiah. I got an incredible anointing on me when I gave you that word before.
Stirring sounds above the grounds, misty shadows gently cleave. Daughters fair, grief forbear, journey to their Savior's tomb. Before daybreak, aloes take, mourners to the shadows gloom. Holy stones, sacred tones, giant boulder rolled away. Borrowed cave, empty grave, where Christ's lifeless body lay. Drawing near, trembling fear, where could they have taken him? Why weepest thou? Whom seekest thou? The living word said unto them. Love enfolding, now beholding, falling at the Master's feet. All transcending, Christ ascending, heaven's mission now complete. Sunrise, eastern skies, heaven's seraphs witnessing, angelic voice, in all rejoice, all glory to the risen King.
Amen.
Amen.
Can we sing There's a Fountain?
Thank you.
think it was as you were saying it the second time.
Okay. The weeping prophet. Okay, thank you, Micah. Amen.
Oh.
Y'all know this, he preaches with me. Micah listens to what I say and he preaches with me.
Amen.
In his own way.
Yes.
And we can hear him worship.
Mm-hmm.
I hear him making sweet sounds. I mean, he savors, and I hear him say, and he worships with us.
Mm-hmm. We love you, Micah.
Yes, we do.
Oh, God, Father.
Amen. Amen. We love you, Micah.
Oh, God, Father.
Yes. Father. We love you.
No, well, I could say that, you know, the Spirit, I forgot the word now, just bypasses everything else of the physical, goes straight to the Spirit.
Okay, and then
anybody can minister.
Right. Our words without the Spirit are dead.
Nothing. Yes.
Well, y'all be blessed. If anybody needs prayer, I'd be glad to pray for you. Our time to eat here is at 1 o'clock,
yes,
so we
yes.
have a few minutes. What time is it?
It's 12:30.
12:30. Okay. 1 hour every